Folks, it never gets old. Another football season, another episode of the Audible podcast. I've been pumped up all day to record this episode. It's episode 247. I'm Jared. I'm joined by my co-host, Adrian. We are here to talk about some reactions from the fall football camp, the unveiling of the 2024 edition of the Triangle of Toughness. Adrian, how's it going, man?
I am pumped. I'm excited. Nothing makes the arrival of the new UTSA football season feel more real than the single-digit jersey announcement. You get to know who the contenders, where you write on your predictions, who are you surprised by, and it just gets you amped up to know these are our guys that are going to lead this team to victory in 2024, man. I love the 2-0 triangle of toughness. I love the single digits. This is like the most exciting part of Jeff Traylor's installed culture, I think, is the unveiling of the single digit numbers.
Yeah, that's a good point. I mean, when I saw the video drop, I think it was on Sunday, right? And I saw that they had posted like a 3-minute long video. I was like, yes, let's go. the time is here. Definitely gets me pumped, and selfishly too, I need time to memorize all the new names and numbers. So once the first game rolls around, I'm not totally clueless trying to figure out who's who out there. So that's nice. Hopefully they can get the update in the new college football video game pretty quickly so I can really learn it that way.
Indeed, very crucial. EA Sports, get on that.
Get on it, man.
Yeah,
I need them to have the direct line to Jeff Traylor, and as soon as those votes are tallied, let's get working on it.
Well, look at how incredible it's sort of become as a part of the culture that fans get excited about it. Because I think whenever the single digits were first announced, like, I think there were some mixed sort of receptions to it.
Yeah,
people were like, oh, this is corny, but some people really liked it, some people weren't too sure. And of course, winning cures all, right?
Yeah.
But you win, and then those guys in the single digits really have proven over the years to be studs. I can't think of a single digit guy that we've had over the Jeff Traylor tenure that has like been a bust.
There's guys that probably haven't performed as well as expected, but they weren't like detrimental to the team or the program.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. And so here we are now in the fifth installment of single digit jersey numbers. Yeah, man. I think everybody is fully on board with it now. And so we're excited to go through not only single-digit numbers and who earned them, but fall camp analysis. Here we are, halfway through fall camp, halfway through August.
First scrimmage in the books.
2 weeks until, give or take, 2 weeks until game one in the Alamo Dome, the season opener.
Before we start breaking all this stuff down, do you want to give some shout-outs just to the new Patreon subscribers? Just like when, it's the single digits get announced, it's the start of football season. Also, when we start rolling in with new subscribers, the time is nigh. So thank you to two brand new subscribers this week, Holly Overmeyer and Evan Moore, joining in the insider tier. And shout out as well to UTSA King Bowser, who upgraded to the Board of Trustees tier. That is amazing. Thank you for your support. And as good a time as any to remind you guys that you have the option to do an annual subscription on Patreon. What is it, a 10% discount? Is that right?
You do get a 10% discount if you subscribe to the annual option. Yes.
Yes. I would say too, if you're a longtime subscriber and you know that you're here for the long haul, go ahead and save some money. Lock in that annual discount and you're good to go. It'll just auto renew for you next year unless you cancel. So it's not just for new subscribers that can take advantage of that. If you're going month by month right now, you can convert at any time. And two, with your savings, you could use that to upgrade to a new tier, too.
Well said, Jared.
And speaking of upgrades, we are preparing our donor gifts for those that subscribe at a booster tier or higher. Everyone receives a very special piece of merch in the mail. We've been doing that for quite a while now. The gifts have always been pretty good. But the Board of Trustees big money donor gift this year is going to be really something. I'm really excited for it.
Yeah, the gifts always seem to get bigger and better. Shout out to our supplier for being able to make that happen for us. And we always get really, really good reception. People seem to love them, and people seem to use them a lot. So that's always good to see. So if you subscribe to the $10 and up tier by the end of August, you will be getting a Patreon gift from Alamo Audible in the mail as our token of appreciation to say thank you. So get those annual subs in, get your monthly signups up. It is football season coming. The amount of exclusive content that we do is out of this world. You have access to Jared's film room study, probably the number one piece of Patreon content as far as our audience reception goes. People love Jared's film room breakdowns. You also get one extra exclusive podcast episode every single week and our next day post game quick immediate reactions. So you get hungover Adrian and Jared talking through the game the very next morning after. So that's always a lot of fun too.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, cool. Adrian, let's start talking single digit guys, 2-1-0 guys. Not a lot of big surprises, I would say, but a couple. You know, yeah. Every year is a few.
I think in the area code in the 2-1-0 countdown city triangle of toughness numbers, I don't know, 2, maybe 3 surprises for me.
Yeah, I'd say so. We won't go and read out every single digit guy. Y'all have the internet. If you're listening to this, you can go find that. You can find the roster. But we'll just focus on the 2-1-0 guys. Rocking the zeros this year. Of course, Oscar Cardenas finally getting the jump to the 2-1-0. I'm wearing one of his shirts here to commemorate the catch that won the West.
Let's go.
Yeah, great stuff. I think Alumni Association should put that shirt out. Joining him is a guy that we just talked in quite in depth about on a recent Patreon episode where we previewed the linebackers. That's Jamal Ligon, due for his 5th year as a starter at UTSA and on the precipice of becoming UTSA's all-time leading tackler. And the ones, probably one of the surprises right here, Joe Evans. Big Joe, returning to UTSA, turning down some NIL deals. He's set for a really big season. JT Clark, obviously, he's not leaving the one, you know, even despite injury. Yeah. Just a cornerstone of this program, and you know we hope he's healthy, ready to go this year. And then wrapping up the 2-1-0 at number 2, Brandon Brown was there last year, running it back once again. But joining him, perhaps UTSA starting quarterback, Owen McCown.
Let's go, Owen.
You got pretty pumped when you saw me the 2, didn't you?
Oh my gosh. You just solidified everything that Jared and I have been talking about on this podcast for the last month. Yes, Owen is our pick for the starting. We do have to throw in the caveat, the perhaps starter, the potential starter, the maybe the starter.
Sure.
Because according to Coach Speak, Jeff Traylor has not announced a starter yet and probably will not until week 2 against the Bobcats. Even if he does it then, it probably won't be until after the Texas State game that we actually know. But
yeah, both guys played well coming out of the game. I can picture it now.
This, I mean, look, the coveted triangle of toughness numbers, to have the 2 be awarded to Owen McCown, I think just speaks of what the roster feels like the quarterback battle is trending towards. And dude, we've heard it ever since last season. I mean, going back to week 2 or 3, whatever week it was when we played Tennessee, and then into the bowl game, all these guys in their press conferences, when they're asked about Owen McCown, they say, Owen is a dog.
Dog.
Owen is a dog.
Dog.
Owen is a dog. And boom, sure enough, that dog came out with that number 2 on the single digit. Yes, sir, indeed. And I, Jared, watching Owen McCown's UTSA football media day interviews, I was getting all of the dog vibes from him with some of those amazing gems he was dropping. He said something about, it doesn't matter if I throw 3 touchdowns out the gate or 3 interceptions, I'm the same dude. Yeah. And they were like, what about pressure, Owen? And he's like, pressure is lack of preparation. If you prepare, there's no pressure. I was like, this dude's a dog, bro. Like, come on. Like, he's just got a different way of ticking. You can tell, grew up in a NFL quarterback tutelage in his home, and just, man, dude, it comes out. He's got the mentality, and Owen McCown is, I'm chalking him down for a tremendous season, rocking the number 2.
Another indicator that he truly is a dog is, you know, they've started featuring him a lot in all of the, you know, kind of fall camp videos they've been posting on social media.
Yeah.
You know, guys being mic'd up and like little interviews that they do or whatever. Owen's in almost all of them now, right? You know, the writing is on the wall. But the one that I really enjoyed was they asked the guys, like, what would be like your starting 5 if you had to pick UTSA football people to, you know, play basketball with? And I think his was like, I can't remember, well, Devin McHugh in a shooting guard. I can't remember who the point guard was. And then him at the three. And I'm like, dude, you're 6'2" and you're calling yourself running the forward, the small forward. Like, that's some dog, you know, he's going to play above the measurements for sure.
Yes. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. So I'm really, really excited for Owen, man. So pretty fantastic stuff to see him get that number two. And, you know, we talked to Frank Harris on the Alumni Association podcast, Birds Up, and we asked him who were his picks to get the single digit numbers, specifically the area code numbers. And he said Oscar Cardenas has to get that zero.
Yeah.
Has to get that zero.
Yeah. And I think he said that's one of the few guys he wouldn't feel a certain kind of way. If he got zero, like other guys, he'd be like, nah, you know, I don't know if he can live up to it. But Oscar, he was all in on, of course.
Absolutely. You know, we love to call him Big O, but I think this year we got to adjust that. It's the big zero, the big zero settle, Oscar Cardenas, bro. And so very, very excited.
Hey, he's not that big anymore, man. He is really slimmed down.
Slimmed down, look at the lean zero, the 0% body fat, Oscar Cardenas, dude. Yes, yes, indeed.
Awesome. Okay, some other observations I had outside the 2-1-0 guys, you know, other than, I guess, Joe Evans and Owen, you know, it's kind of as expected. But one thing that was interesting to me just when I pulled up the roster is how many of these guys are transfers, you know? Joe Evans, LSU, Brandon Brown, Tulane, Owen McCowan, Colorado, Chris Carpenter, Colorado, Elliot Davidson, UIW. I don't think any of the offensive linemen. Oh, yeah. CJ James, New Mexico.
CJ James.
He's also triangle toughness. Yeah.
But guys.
Pretty good percentage, you know?
Yeah. But each of those guys has been here, what, for 2 seasons now?
A lot of them have. But
yeah.
I just think it goes to show that they're able to get the transfers but to buy into the culture. I think it's a lot easier to sell a high school recruit on the culture when, like, you recruited them at a young age. Like, excuse me, they've been on official visits, right? They've talked to the guys and all that. But the transfer portal can be a lot more transactional in a lot of cases. I think UTC does a good job of not treating it that way like other schools do. But that was really interesting. Like, I don't know if every program in America, if they had, you know, the single digit thing, if they would have that high of a percentage of guys being single digit transferring from other schools.
Robert Henry, JUCO transfer. Dude, I also like seeing the double ups at the position. I love that we have two running backs get single digits with Robert Henry and Kavorian Barnes. I think that shows that running back room not only is super talented, but has a whole lot of leadership within it too.
Dude, what about 4 offensive linemen? Has that ever happened before?
I don't think so. I think we had, what, 2 last year, maybe?
You got CJ James, Corey Gonet, Vinley Tatafu, Makai Hart. That's beefy. That's like 1,200 pounds of offense right there.
Vinley's really been talked up by Jeff Traylor throughout this offseason, and it sounds like he's really, really high and got a lot of expectations for Vinley. And I don't know if he'll be fully ready to go week 1, but you can tell that he's having a hell of a camp and he had a hell of an offseason. He should be a force, a really, really big anchor piece on that offensive line. Mm-hmm. Any other surprises at the single digit, Jared?
I don't know if it's really a surprise. I wasn't surprised by it, but some people, you know, noted that there's 2 quarterbacks in the single digit. You know, while Owen McCowan is not a 2-1-0, he did get that number 9.
Eddie Lee.
Really cool to see. Oh, yeah, sorry, Eddie Lee, my bad.
Eddie Lee Marburger got that number 9. Yeah, and that's, you know, it's voted on by the team, so clearly.
Mm-hmm.
Eddie Lee is a commanding presence, commanding voice in the locker room, whether he's going to be in the starter or not. Yeah.
Yeah, and there's precedence for that. Like, remember, Josh Atkins wore number 5, and he started, what, 2-3 games or something like that? Played very really true. Well.
Very true. Very true. It's not the first time we've had 2 quarterbacks up there. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There's one surprises. Guy that surprised me, Zay Frazier, getting in a number 3.
A number 3, man.
That's really interesting. I mean, because Zay was a guy that missed time last year because he had an academic issue. And he was asked about that in media days, and he had a very, like, honest and mature answer. He's like, you know, I wasn't taking care of business. I took full ownership and responsibility for it. It's fixed, you know, and now I'm here. I'm ready to play, right? So that was cool to see. And, you know, we talked about this on the Patreon episode with Donnie Taylor as well, but it's just so rewarding as a fan to see some of these guys that you know have had some issues off field. You know, nothing like crazy, like crime or anything like that. But just guys that didn't really have it all together, you know, mentally. Yeah. they weren't ready to step into the game at the collegiate level and all the higher expectations of discipline and responsibility that's required for it. And then to see those guys then turn into single digit guys, that's really cool to see, right? Because you're not just building a football team. You're not just building a program. Like, you're really changing those kids' lives, right? And that's awesome. It's really easy to root for those kind of guys.
Yeah, as Jeff Traylor says it, knuckleheads, right? Yeah. And so they go from knuckleheads to really maturing and becoming more of men. And, you know, the other part of that is you always hear these players talk about how Jeff Traylor and the coaching staff develop them off the field just as much as they do on the field. Mm-hmm. And I guess that's another big reason why the culture of 210 Triangle of Toughness has been able to stick so well with these guys, is because it doesn't just have to do with what they're doing in the huddle, what they're doing on the turf, but what they're doing outside, what they're doing in the classroom, what they're doing in their personal lives, what they're doing in their family lives. And it's incredible to hear so many different guys echo the same thing throughout their press conferences, because I don't think they're being fed their answering points and their talking points like, you know, maybe some coaches are at other programs or some players are at other programs. I really do feel like you're getting genuine answers when you hear so many players talk about, we believe in the culture. So many players talk about, he develops trust us on the field. He develops us off the field. Trust the process. I've just been trusting the process, trying to rehab, trying to get better, trusting the process, be patient. It's incredible to hear that sort of thing, man, from so many different guys always saying it.
Mm-hmm. Yep, absolutely.
I guess mine, one surprise, got to be Chris Carpenter getting a single digit.
Yeah. It sounds like, you know, based off the video they posted, that they're going to pick one special team guy every year.
Yeah.
With, you know, a new punter, you know, Chase Allen's only been here a year. He's a transfer. Mm-hmm. Chris Carpenter makes sense, you know, when you think of it that way.
It does. It does. I know we've always had, like, well, I shouldn't say always, but last year we maybe had a little bit bigger of expectations for Chris Carpenter. Mm-hmm. Maybe this is the year where some of that comes to fruition.
And I think even if he's just an excellent punt return, kick return guy, like, you got to take that as enough too. I mean, that really helps a team win ball games. So
absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. But,
you know, definitely snaps to be had at wide receiver. Production to be made, right? So let's hope he puts it all together. I mean, we saw in that bowl game, man, he was I guess it was two bowl games ago, right, when we played Troy, he was just so close to a couple of touchdowns and, you know, just couldn't hang on the ball, couldn't make the catch, right? So
that's right,
we've seen those flashes of greatness,
and I like there. To see that in a wide receiver room that does graduate a lot of talent but had a lot of talent come in to refill and reload. Chris Carpenter carving a name for himself, even amongst some pretty beefy, talented transfers.
Yeah. Speaking of the receivers, man, how about Devin McEwen getting the number 3?
Yes.
This true sophomore?
Sir.
That's awesome. Yeah, we didn't really get to hear much from Devin as a freshman last year, but in his media availability, man, he's a sharp guy, man. You can tell he's super intelligent, for sure.
Jeff Traylor has also name dropped Devin a lot this offseason or this fall camp. Yeah, he always kind of goes out of his way to highlight the guys that he's kind of high on. We talked about Vinley already. Devin's another name that he's dropped a lot. And so is Zay Frazier, which on the Zay Frazier point, Jared, Traylor talked 2 to 3 weeks ago and told us that the big question marks are at the cornerback position. But Football Media Day, I don't know if it was Greg Luca or somebody had asked him about the cornerback position. He was like, oh, we're just fine at that position.
Okay.
We're going to be just fine right there. We're good at cornerback. So I was like, oh, man. He talked about how much talent was in the room. Talked about how they were already getting coached up the right way. Mm-hmm. So, dude, yes. Yes, defense.
I feel like that answer is going to tell us more about Cyrus Dumas and Zach Morris than it probably does about Frazier or Denver Harris.
Because Zach Morris was a guy that Jeff Traylor spent a little while talking about in that same interview.
Yeah. Another guy seems very, very mature.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And in his interview immediately, today, he threw some digs at Albuquerque. Did you catch that one?
Oh, no, I don't think so.
I think Greg asked him why he left New Mexico, and he was like, well, there's a coaching change, and like I was planning to stick around and see through it or whatever. But then I thought about it, and I was like, I really don't like that city.
Dang, dog, the 505. Come on, bro. The Boudica, dog. Dude, that's brutal. Oh, man. And I don't know. I guess to, like, the outside world, what did people say? Like, Albuquerque to San Antonio is, like, a lateral move in terms of, like, cityscape.
I don't know.
Probably not. But, dude. Yeah, that's funny. Well, I hope he's enjoying San Antonio.
Yeah, I hope so as well. That cracked me up. It makes me wonder, too, if any guys that have left UTSA have ever made comments like that to the local media. I'm just new school.
Ready to get the hell out of San Antonio. No. I don't think anyone's ever said anything bad about San Antonio in the history of that city. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, cool. Any other thoughts, observations on the single digit guys?
No. Very excited.
Any guy that didn't get a 210 number or a single digit number that you were a little surprised didn't make it cut?
I think so, Jared. I think maybe Robert Henry surprised me more. Maybe I like expected to see Rocco Griffin more than I expected to see Robert Henry.
That's fair.
But that's probably it.
I think the only thing for me, none of the misses on single digits surprised me. Like, I just scrolled through the roster and like there are some that, you know, I could have seen them getting it. David Amador, maybe. I think the only one that surprised me is I really thought Donye Taylor would be a 210 guy. I thought he would have got the spot that Joe Evans got. That one did shock me a little bit.
Okay, so instead of just a single digit, you thought Donye was a area code guy.
I did, yep.
Makes sense.
But him staying at that number 7 is cool, too. Excited for that.
Well, maybe, you know, they don't want to overload multiple positions at the 210, right? And Jamal's got to get the area code as a linebacker before Donye does. And then maybe Donye this is Donye's last. Does he have one more year of eligibility?
I think it's his last year.
This is his last year. Yeah. Well, maybe that would be my guess behind it. If I were to speculate, if I were to go conspiracy, it would be really sure. One guy.
But Brandon Browder. Who were the guys that Traylor said got every single vote? Was it Ligon and Cardenas?
It has to be. Yeah, I think the zeros. Yeah. I think the zeros every single vote.
How cool is that, man? Completely unanimous. Like, I feel like nothing in society is unanimous for anything these days. But
never.
At UTSA, they find those two guys to go into the zero completely. You know, I do wonder if they, you know, fudge the numbers a little bit. But, you know, there's got to be one hater out there, right?
Fully agreed upon who is going to lead us. Yeah, you would think, man. I mean, it's hard to imagine that there's not any of that jealousy, hate, animosity, whatever you want to call it, right? Even if it's spirited competition, got to be some guys like, but unanimous is pretty impressive for Oscar and Jamal. Mm-hmm. And I think it's fair to say, at least amongst us, they've certainly got some of the highest expectations on their respective sides of the ball.
Yeah, absolutely. 100%. Well, Adrian, before we start giving some of our camp takeaways, you want to shout out a couple Board of Trustees members on Patreon?
Yes, absolutely. A big, big thank you to our Board of Trustees. That is Digi Teak, John Otwell, Gary and Ruben representing the UTSA Bird Gang Tailgate, Ray Redding and Meat Meep Apparel, Brandon Grell and the Grell Realty Group, Andy Elizalde and Proficient Benefit Solutions, Ian McLendon and Seeker LLC, Ryan Squires, Waterman Construction, Javon Townsend, Vice President of the Dallas-Fort Worth Chapter of the UTSA Alumni Association, UTSA's annual giving, make sure you are giving to UTSA, Artisan Vapor and CBD, Wayne Gonzalez and the Runners Rising Project.
Yeah, and I'll throw in two additional shout-outs on top of those Board of Trustees shout-outs. Shout-out to Waterman Construction. Andrew Waterman recently announced him and his family are creating an endowed scholarship at UTSA.
Wow.
Fantastic. That's amazing. And shout out to Runners Rising Project. I am a volunteer there, are doing the Tailgate Challenge again this year. It's always our highest grossing fundraising activity. So, you know, once that is launched, get out there and support your favorite tailgates and Lot B and Lot C, and let's raise some money for some UTSA student athletes.
Let's go.
In addition, do you want to give a shout out to all of our big money donors on Patreon, including Ben Tovar, the Bunch Family, Zach Espedacueta on the San Antonio Podcast Network, Alejandro Benavides, Dan Erdahl, host of Around the Birdbath, Jacob Vasos, board president of the UTSA Alumni Association, great to chat with Jacob on their recent episode where they had us on as guests. So stay tuned for that. Should be dropping soon. And then also shout out to John Nally, Rick Cortez of Rowdy Road Grillers, Sumner McDaniel, and Homefield Apparel, where you can use code UTSA Once Homefield to get 15% off of your first order. So thank you guys all so much. We're going to hit you guys with a little Kumia break, and we'll be back to talk some fall camp takeaways. All right, folks, welcome back to episode 247 of the Alamo Audible Podcast, a proud member of the Dave Campbell's Texas Football Republic of Football Podcast Network. I was going to reach and grab my episode or my edition of the magazine that I just got in the mail today, but it's a little bit outside of arm's reach. I don't want to go off camera for that because we're on video. Ah, screw it. I'll do it.
You can do it. It's okay.
Go out there. It's at your local H-E-B newsstand. Let's support our friends at Dave Campbell's. Look how massive this thing is, man. That's where it gets bigger every year. So there's I got a reason trip coming up. I'm excited to crack that thing open on the Frio River.
Shout out to, gosh, what a sight that would be. You need to get that picture, Jared Reed in the Bible of Texas football, right there on the Frio. That should be plastered right there on Dave Campbell's website.
That's what I love about Texas. That
is phenomenal. That is phenomenal, man. Incredible. Incredible. God. And also, folks, don't forget, as game one and UTSA football approaches rapidly, don't wear that same stained, ripped, old shirt to the games. Visit the Alamo Audible fan shop to get some new gear for game day. We've got his and hers. We've got tops, we've got hats, jackets, sweaters, you name it.
Yeah, some new items in the works as well, so stay tuned.
Very good stuff.
I was talking to the guys the other day, and I said, fellas, we're overdue for a new collection. Let's get on it. So stay tuned. But yeah, let's talk about fall camp, man. You know, it's I would say it's a pretty good flow of information coming out of camp. Some years we get a ton. Some years it's like radio silence. And I would say, like, right now, it's, like, right in the middle. I didn't hear a lot from the scrimmage, unfortunately. You know, I feel like there's always someone that gets to watch a scrimmage and, you know, secondhand, thirdhand, it gets back to me. But didn't hear much this year. Unfortunately, don't know why it is. But I feel like we still have learned a lot about this team, you know, in the past week and a half or whatever it might be.
Jeff Traylor sounded like he was impressed with how evenly matched the ones and twos were on offense and defense from the scrimmage. And he did go out of his way to say the threes were a little bit lackluster and need some more work to get up. But yeah, it sounded like offense and defense were giving themselves a hell of a battle. So we're not too one-sided on either side of the ball.
Yeah. Kind of interesting to hear that about the threes, though, because we've all been saying, even external from the program, that this is UTSA's deepest roster ever. Mm. So do you think that is like a side effect of there being a lot of position battles going on and like ones and twos are getting more run than they typically would?
It could be part of that. It could be partly transfers getting ingrained into a new program and trying to figure themselves out. You know, we've learned over the last season or two that we'll get a real big transfer or a transfer that people are pretty high on, and then they don't end up really seeing the field too much through the 12 and 13 games of UTSA football.
Sure.
And so I think there's a little bit more of an acclimation process in adapting to the new playbook, the new culture, getting up to speed. That just has to happen. Whether you're coming from a P5 or a JUCO, you're on a different program now, and you've got to get up to speed with that.
I'll say too, something that I try to catch myself, because I struggle with this sometimes, is sometimes these big time transfers come in and they've got the accolades, right? They're really highly rated recruits. But you think about it, and they're still like 19, 20-year-old sophomore, you know, redshirt freshman in some cases too.
Right.
So like you would have more patience with them if they were a high school recruit. So got to keep that in mind as well.
But, you know, some of these transfers come over, and I think maybe they're also served a little bit of that humble Kool-Aid, baby.
Sure. Yeah.
You know, there's some dogs here at UTSA, you know, you come here because you want to get that playing spot. You think you can get those snaps, but they still got to be earned. They still got to be earned.
Yeah, the days of being a Power 5 transfer and walking into UTSA and getting right into the depth chart on day one, those days are long gone, you know?
It's a wild thing for you to say, Jared. It's absolutely true, but never could have imagined you saying that just a couple years ago.
Yeah, I know. The game has changed too, though, right? That's not just a UTSA thing. I think that's true for a lot of programs, right? I think the top talent is probably more accumulated at the top of the sport, but I think that medium level of talent's a little bit more distributed now. Because I think guys, you know, they're quicker to go into the portal and go find playing time somewhere.
Jared, is this the first time that we've done UTSA football media days to like this level? I don't ever recall like having this full on devoted 2 or 3 hours of just guys getting 10 and 15 minutes of FaceTime, or at least not this long of a list of guys getting it. It seemed like a new thing to me, and I might just be recalling it incorrectly, but.
You know, at first I was going to disagree with you, but I think you're partially right. I think like it's always been a pretty big production for Media Day, but I think in the past it's always been like an hour of talking with the coordinators.
Yes.
And then I think now they just have more kids get to talk.
Yeah. The players got a lot of FaceTime, and it wasn't like 3-minute snippets that we usually get with names that we're unfamiliar with. No, I mean, these guys were getting full on 8, 10, 12 minutes. And you really got to learn the guy. And I really, really enjoyed the UTSA media day that was happening.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's kind of bittersweet. You know, I definitely really enjoy hearing from the coordinators when we get a chance. You know, some programs, they have the coordinators do media availability every week. And for the most part of UTSA, even under Coker and Wilson, it's like you get 30 minutes at the start of the season, and that's all you'll ever hear from them.
Yeah.
So, you know, it'd be nice to get a little bit more. I mean, I feel like I still don't really know a lot about Justin Burke as a person, right? I don't even know if I know what his voice sounds like.
Good point. Yeah.
Yeah. So I would like a little bit more exposure for those guys. And, you know, we hear from Jess Lepp a bit. You know, he's a more vocal guy. He's a little bit more out there in the public, right? Mm-hmm. But that would be nice, you know, to hear from some more coaches more often. On the other hand, though, it was really cool to get to know a lot of these guys, especially some of these new incomers, and get to hear their stories. In particular, really, really enjoyed hearing from CJ James. I mean, that's a guy, he's had a unique path to where he's at now.
Yeah.
You know, late to the game of football. I think he said that he didn't play football until his sophomore year of high school, and wasn't varsity until his senior year. Does that sound right?
Yeah. Yeah. It's amazing.
Went the JUCO route and just climbed his way up, you know. He was all conference player in the Mountain West in New Mexico. Now it looks like he's, you know, pretty much a lock to be the starting center at UTSA, and you know, surpassing a really good center in Luke LePays, right? So,
yeah, man. I mean,
that was one of the position battles that we'd highlighted heading into the fall, right? We knew CJ James was going to be good. Was he going to be good enough to beat out Luke LePays? I think, like, our opinion at the time was, like, if he is, that's a really good sign for this offensive line. And we saw that clip of him pancaking someone in a one-on-one drill at the start of camp, and we're like, yeah, I think he's got this.
He's mean, dude, and he's big, dude, 310 pounds. And I think, Jared, this is probably not the first, but one of the few instances where a transfer comes in and earns potentially a starting spot right away that first season. I don't recall it happening too many times.
I don't know. It was really quick with CJ. Really, really quick. But
really, really quick. But I mean, to just get here right away from New Mexico, had a year Abilene Christian, goes to New Mexico, is a stud, and he comes over here and immediately makes a name for himself.
And it's not just getting the starting spot. I mean, I'm sure if we were to pour through the record books, that's certainly happened a couple times. But to get voted into the Triangle of Toughness as quickly as he did, that feels pretty unprecedented.
That's insane.
Right.
That's insane. That doesn't happen.
And I think it says a lot about his character, right? Like in his media availability, he was like so honest. He was so raw. He was so vulnerable. He just showed a lot of like emotional intelligence, I would say. That's really rare, right? For, you know, a collegiate football player, you know, to kind of be able to talk about their feelings and like how they overcame it and like the lows and the highs that they've gone through and all that. I was really impressed, man. And they had him mic'd up at practice recently. He's a funny guy, man. He brings out the best in people. He kind of reminds me of Frank a little bit in the way that, you know, he's able to joke around with the guys and keep the spirits up. But you also know that, you know, he can kind of, you know, wrangle a group, right, when they're acting out. And I can't remember who it was, but one of the guys in the interview said that, you know, CJ's one of the more vocal guys. Like, when we're not performing the way we should be when we're slacking off of practice, he's the first one, you know, to kind of put the foot down and say, you know, let's get it together. We're here for a reason, right?
That's right.
And to be a transfer to come in and do that, ah, man, that's really special. That's really impressive.
Leadership qualities. Yeah, you get here and you're demanding excellence from your teammates in practice. You're getting on them.
Mm-hmm.
And you just got here, right? And there's a guy who's been here for 2 or 3 years, and he's like, who the hell are you to be yelling at me to do better, right? But then you see him out there giving 150% every single snap. Yeah, you better get with it. Mm-hmm. You better get with it. And it's sort of that demand, that leadership that I think is really what separates guys that get into that single digit accolade.
Yeah.
Right. Definitely. And it's something that Frank Harris alluded to whenever we were talking to him.
Yeah. CJ did share, you know, his aspirations of getting to the NFL, right? Big reason why he made the jump to come to UTSA, because he felt like it was going to put him in the best spot to make that jump to the next level. And, you know, from what we've seen so far, he's definitely got it on and off the field. Don't want to set expectations unfairly high, but this is an all-conference player we're talking about here. So that's, I think, right. It's fair, right, to bring that up. And yeah, it's really exciting. Definitely one of those kind of camp spotlights, the guys that you don't know a whole lot about, you get to know a little bit about them, and they become a fan favorite pretty quick.
Yeah. And well, you know, it sounded like there was a lot of searching for who was going to provide the vocal leadership to UTSA on both sides of the ball, with Frank leaving, with Rashad leaving, with so many guys leaving, veteran presence leaving. And it seems like we've gotten our answers here with CJ James and Oscar Cardenas on the offensive side, Donye Taylor and Brandon Brown, it sounds like, on the defensive side.
Mm-hmm.
Really providing that vocal leadership out there. And so, yeah, these are the guys. These are the guys that are going to be getting on to their teammates, but also, Jared, like you say, be able to laugh with them, push them around a little bit. And they've earned the right to have that command from them.
Yeah. And I think they take after their head coach, right? Like, don't you think Jeff is like that, you know, away from the cameras at practice, where he's joking around with guys, but then when he sees something he doesn't like, you know, he's going to get on you pretty quick.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I would love to see like the behind closed doors.
Yeah. Hard knocks, UTSA.
Jeff Traylor. Yeah. Jeff Traylor a little ticked off about performance, because I know he lays into some dudes. He's got to. He's a Texas high school football coach.
Yeah. dude, I wonder like what on field thing has gotten Jeff Traylor the most pissed off through his career at UTSA.
Well, you know what he's going to tell you? It's the things that he's done, like his bonehead.
Sure. In
the penalty, bonehead penalty.
12 men on the field against 12 Houston, men against 2021.
Yeah. But there's someone that someone has done that he has just been infuriated by.
I can't wait to have someone on the podcast in like 5 years and ask him that question.
What was the most pissed off you ever saw Jeff Traylor? Frank Harris could probably answer that question for us now. He's graduated.
Yep. But true. But I feel like once Jeff has left the program, you'd probably get an even more honest answer.
Right. That's when it really opens up that door. Yeah. True.
Because I know, like, I've noticed when we have former players on, like, they'll be pretty open and honest with us, like, if they're 1 year out from playing. But when they're a couple years out, like, they just don't really care anymore, and they'll really tell you, you know, stuff they wouldn't otherwise.
Oh, yeah.
Like, remember when Austin Pride on, like, some of the stuff he was telling us, I was like, dude, I cannot believe that you're sharing this.
Dude, absolutely. I mean? And those guys that were here during those rough periods, you know, they shared that frustration that they had with the coaching staff under Wilson or whatever it was.
Right. Yeah.
When things got
Josiah
tough.
Too. And Josiah's like Fossey's guy. And
you let it unfilter for a little bit.
Yeah.
Really, go listen to our old interviews with Austin Pratt and Josiah Taua'efa. Those are great, great guys.
Those are some gems for sure.
So we did get some other, like, Jared, I was appalled at some of the players' interviews telling us about their injuries that they had.
Yeah.
It sounds like last year, Jeff Traylor was throwing out some pretty hobbled dudes. Joe Evans said he was having his PCL issues since week 3. And he played all season long. And didn't actually get in surgery until after the bowl game win in December. And Luca was like, when did that start aggravating you? He was like, oh, probably like week 3. I was like, what?
Yeah, and he had a good season too, you know? Like, he didn't play to his potential, I didn't think, but he had a good season, right?
Yes.
It's crazy. You know, I think we'd already known about Kevorian Barnes a little bit, that he had played through some pretty serious shoulder injuries as well, but that sounded much worse than we knew that it was, right? He had a metal plate in his shoulder or whatever.
Right. Well, and you had three other running backs in that room that you could have ran. You didn't have to have Kevorian running out there hobbled and getting beat up like that, right? The same thing with JT Clark. JT Clark is running on a partially torn ACL, getting garbage time snaps for literally no reason in 2023. And how long has that delayed his progress more? Mm. If not forever? It is extremely concerning stuff to hear, and I just think that that needs to be shed some light on.
Yeah, for sure. It's tough to know, like, what's a medical oversight versus being too risky and rushing guys back really quickly. It's a super fine line, right? You know, football players are tough, right? They're not going to tell you about pain. They're going to try their best to get on the field and play through it. It's tough, man, but... It does seem like it's been a bit of an issue under Traylor, and you know, the wins speak for themselves, right? You find a way to win, and that's what it's all about. But
yeah,
you know, I'm sure there's been situations that Traylor and the staff might look back and regret and realize they made a mistake. But you know, hopefully they learn from that and they know exactly how to turn that knob. It's not an exact science, right? It's not like there's a machine the doctor hooks you up to and it says, "Yep, you're good to go" or something like that,
right? Right.
So it's tough, you know.
Do we need to be more proactive with that imaging, with the X-rays, with the MRIs? Do we need to look at that on a more frequent basis whenever a guy is in recovery or something like that?
Some of these guys, like, we know for sure they went and got MRIs done and stuff like that, and they're still like missing stuff, or they're still playing through tears. Like,
yeah,
no, it's kind of weird, right?
And then we hear about some guys that kind of currently have injuries that they're trying to battle through, right? Mm-hmm. David Amador mentioned that he's
hamstring,
dealing with a hamstring injury, right? So how soon
he seemed a little frustrated in his interview, didn't you think?
He absolutely did. He kind of had a very stout sort of stone face. His tone did not appear too jubilant whenever he was talking. Mm-hmm. Was he frustrated with his injury? Was he also frustrated with how his recovery process has been?
Oh, Adrian is trying to stir the pot. Here we go. Dude,
look, man, I just, you know, we've got to point these things out.
Yeah, it's a fair question to ask.
Wouldn't be doing this job if we weren't. But yeah, I mean, guys, you know, guys get frustrated for multiple reasons, man. And here you are on the precipice of a new season start, and you've got big expectations for yourself as well as everyone else. How's it for you? You want to get out there. You want to be in your best. Mm-hmm. And whenever you can't, you're being held back, or you feel like you're not getting the support you're getting.
Yeah.
Look, these are young kids, man.
But I mean, I think overall it's a pretty good narrative, good story when it comes to the injuries. You know, it doesn't seem like there's been anything super major, no season ending stuff. JT said he feels like he's a little bit ahead of where he was last year. If you think about it, last year, he played in that Houston game. He shouldn't have, but he did play in it.
It's insane to think.
Yeah, I know, right. So I think it's going to be the same as last year. You know, if we see JT in the second half of the season, we'll consider that a win, right? But you got to just set expectations really low, right? And it's a bonus, right? If he's able to come out and produce, whether he's old JT or not, you know, your UTSA, you know, a 70% JT is going to be, you know, probably as good, if not better, than anyone else you're going to have, because he's that special player. But
that's right.
Just, you know, for his sake, man, I just really hope, you know, he makes that full recovery and turns the corner, because we know what he's capable of, and he's just a great guy.
Big shout out to JT Clark, man. Want to see him on the field this season, but only if he's healthy and ready.
Yeah. As far as, you know, getting healthy and ready, as Mekhi Hart said, he expects to be ready for game one.
Let's go.
I think we were talking about in that Patreon episode that, you know, Owen Peewee's like kind of the X factor on the defense. Like, he's not going to make or break the success of that defense, but if he plays really good, it's going to take it to a different level. I still feel about Mekhi Hart as well. I think the offensive line will be good without him. But if he's healthy and he plays to his ceiling, oh yeah. Oh yeah, like this, you know, championship expectations, 100%. If Mekhi Hart can play the way that we have saw him play, I guess it's been 3 years now, Adrian.
2020, since he was out there. 2020, second team, all CUSA. 2021, honorable mention, all CUSA. 2022. Two starts, season-ending injury. 2023, plays in two games, season-ending injury.
Brutal, man. Brutal. You talk about a guy who's easy to root for, too. You know, he was talking in his media availability. I think we've heard a little bit of this before, but he's got two children, right? And I don't think they live in San Antonio with him. And he's, like, you know, working the, like, the side jobs just to get some extra income and all that, and you know, just all that he's gone through with those injuries, man. I have so much respect for him to continue to tough it out. And I mean, there's just no questioning how much that man loves football to go through all that he's gone through, and you know, to still be out there grinding away. So it sounds like, you know, they're taking a light on him in practice, and you know, if he can go, it's just a big difference maker for UTSA.
Big spirit, big spirit for Mekhi Hart, man. The dude loves the game, very, very passionate. What do you think, Jared, about, you know, the priority of getting a guy who is on the fence on the field against freaking Kennesaw State, dude? Like, is it that important that you rush out a, I don't know, 85% or questionable Mekhi Hart or David Amador or whoever it is, trying to get him out there against Kennesaw State? Or do you just let the twos get out there and get some snaps and get some run in? Save these guys for Texas State whenever you're going to need them.
Well, that 1 week is not going to make or break anything for the recovery, right?
Sure.
But I think getting back to game speed reps does make a difference, right? I think that first game back from injury, there's always going to be that adjustment period. And if you kind of work that out on the fly against Kennesaw State, I think that's a good thing, right? But you just, you know, again, you got to make that really inexact health judgment of, you know, how recovered are they? And, you know, do they still have all the mobility and all that kind of stuff, which, you know, it's really tough for sure. But I would say it's not Kennesaw State that they're, you know, going to want to rush them back for, but just to get on the field in general and see game snaps, right?
Very, very good point. Yeah. Some game speed, some game snaps, and some full contact, right? Because we don't do that in practice. So guys got to get used to that to a degree as well.
Just, you know, get the jitters out too. I mean, even a guy like Mekhi that's played at a high level and it has had a lot of success, you're still going to be like super amped up that first time out on the field, right? And you got to find a way to flush it and just get out there and play ball and not be in your head too much.
No doubt. Yeah, that's a good point.
Well, speaking of Mekhi Hart, keeping on the offensive line, one guy that we saw get a ton of shout-outs from a lot of different folks and the interviews and the coaching interviews and stuff like that, Jalen Garth sounds like he's right there in the mix to start at offensive tackle, which is good to see. You know, they brought in a lot of transfers on that offensive line, a lot of Power 5 guys. Jalen Garth, the guy from Houston, sounds like he's probably leading that bunch right now, 6'6", 320. And only redshirt junior, too. So he's got, you know, if he gets in starting rotation this year, he's got one more year left at UTSA.
Was an East Texas boy, man. Poor Neches Groves, dude.
Is it Neches? I always thought it was Neches.
Might be Neches.
Yeah. I think they just call it the PNG out there. You know, that's what the locals call it, right?
Yeah. I know some folks from around that area. Absolutely, man. This Jalen Garth, dude, the size on him, just unbelievably impressive. Mm-hmm. Unbelievably impressive, man. Yeah. I would love to see him be a big impact guy, and he certainly got the talent to do that right away here.
And I remember the Houston guys were pretty high on him. He just, you know, kind of suffered through injuries a lot.
Yeah.
While he was over there, you know, similar to Wyrick at Stanford. Like when he was on the field, he was really productive and really good, but just could never really stay healthy. So, if he's able to, you know, keep that under control, you know, could be a really nice boost. And you know, you just think about the guys that we haven't listed yet, you know, Jonah Miller, Buffalo Cruz, Kamar, Missouri, all those guys. Man, the depth is so crazy on the offensive line.
Yeah, we've heard Buffalo's name get dropped here and there. I haven't heard too much about him, but I do expect him to be a contributor this season.
Yeah. Not a lot about Jonah Miller. I don't recall seeing him mention much.
Right.
I think Kamar, Missouri's gotten a couple mentions.
But you know, who guys continue to talk about, and yeah, sure, he's on the other side of the ball, but Johnny Bowens, man, keeps getting name dropped left and right, and people have just been extremely impressed, coaches and teammates alike, on his just immediate impact. It sounds like he's kind
of, dude, I think it was like the first day of practice they had Brandon Brown in front of the media, and he was like, yeah, Johnny Bowens is a monster.
Yeah, some guys have it, right? And it's just apparent, it's just obvious whenever they do.
Yeah, I mean, who knows what happened at Oregon, but his athleticism is just so rare at this level. I mean, it's just a level of, you know, force that you're just not going to see much at the group of five, right? It was hard for me to imagine him being a total bust, but it sounds like he's gonna be taking some names this year. And, you know, I was talking with some buddies yesterday, and I was like, there's going to be G5 offensive linemen, or G5 offensive line, that had to find a way to block Brandon Brown, Joe Evans, and Johnny Bowens at the same time. Just one of those guys is a game breaker, and you have to block all three of them.
Salty.
Yep.
Really, really salty, man.
They're going to open up so many tackle for losses for those, like, edge linebackers, Jamori Robinson, Donnie Taylor, Owen Peewee, all those guys, just because they're going to suck up so many blocks and so much space in the interior. There was a video from scrimmage, and I was watching it on Instagram, so it's vertical, you know, and okay. I saw a player drift into the frame, and I had to, like, instantly, like, scrub back, because I was like, dude, that man is a statue. Who is that? I thought it was going to be Kendrick Blackshire, because, like, we know that Blackshire's massive. Johnny Bowens, man.
Oh,
out there looking like an NFL defensive end, dude.
Dude. Holy cow, man. Yeah, yeah. It might be in the runnings for newcomer of the year this season.
Yeah,
Johnny we'll Bowens, dude.
We'll see.
Yeah, yeah. The hype is real. The hype is real for him.
Yeah, him versus CJ James, offense versus defense, should be a good one.
Nice. Oh, yeah.
And, you know, too, you think about a guy like Bowens, he came in late. He wasn't there for the summer. Wasn't there for the spring, obviously. His first week of practice, he's probably going against the third string offensive line quite a bit. Can you imagine what that probably looked like?
Oh, man, not at all. But you make a great point. Like, these G5 offensive linemen going up against these dudes that were P5 material and four-star, three-star guys. And they are going at it every single day in practice against each mm-hmm. other, right? You talk about CJ James versus Johnny Bowen. I mean, if those are the guy, if they're battling each other during practice, wherever they line up against Temple's linemen, right? I mean, dude, dominance. You're
going to see some dominance out there. You got to throw Shady Temple, man. They didn't do nothing to ask for that.
Yeah. I mean, I was going to say Texas State, but I guess I needed to pick a conference peer.
Yeah. I mean, they have some good dudes over there, but yeah. Yeah, I feel you. I always think back to that Middle Tennessee game. I can't remember what year it was, but they couldn't block anyone on UTSA's defensive line. And I think it was Baker. I can't remember who it was. Just went through completely untouched, just flattened stock still. Just like pretty much ended his career. He's like a GA a year later.
Yeah. You know? Yeah.
Not that I want anyone to get hurt or anything like that, but I think just that level of dominance, I think we're going to see it in several games this year.
Yeah.
And as a defensive line junkie, gets the gears going for me. Mm-hmm. I'm
going to blow up some dudes, going to blow up some lines. Absolutely.
Another guy that's impressed on the defense is Brevin Randall. You know, out of all the transfers that you just got of the linebacker group, you know, Randall was the one that was not a Power 5 transfer. He came from Louisiana Tech.
Yeah.
And before that, he was at SFA, right? So he's had kind of that CJ James path to UTSA where, you know, under-recruited out of high school and just slowly kind of work your way up incrementally to see how high that you can rise. And, you know, it sounds, you know, there was a really interesting quote from Coach Traylor where he said something to the effect of, like, Brevin is just really enjoying being on a good team, on a good defense, for once. Which I kind of laughed at, because I know that Traylor is, like, close buds with, like, the SFA staff and some of those guys that were at Louisiana Tech when he was there. So,
yeah.
I don't know if he realized how that might come off. That made me laugh a little bit. But, you know, we mentioned it again on the Patreon. I promise I'm not just plugging that all the time so you guys subscribe. It was a good discussion. But, you know, when I watched Randall's film, he was in the right place and doing the right thing on a lot of plays, but he was not getting, like, the help from the safeties or from the other linebacker from the defensive line to shut down a play. Like, he did his part, but it was still, like, a busted play because the rest of the defense wasn't holding up their end of the bargain. So, right. Now that he is on a good defense where, you know, you got talent at every position, really, I don't think there's anywhere on this defense that you don't feel comfortable that UTSA has, like, legitimate Division One skill. Right everywhere. I think he's going to be much more comfortable and, you know, able to, you know, just kind of fit in schematically and plug the gap and, you know, cover the receiver he's got to recover or whatever. So really excited for that. Sounds like I think he'll probably be the starter with Martavis French eligibility, probably unlikely to be cleared up
for right.
week one.
But it'd be really impressive, you know, even knowing that Martavis doesn't have that eligibility, but it's still really impressive for Brevin Randall to come in here and earn that starting spot as a transfer right away, right? Like how we're talking about with CJ James.
It's played a lot of snaps, man. That always helps.
Well, we know he's fiery. We know he's got some intensity.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
so, yeah.
Gotta bottle it, man.
It's got to come out one way or another. Come out the right way. Yes.
Yeah. Dude, speaking of, did you see that video from App State practice where some dude swung a helmet? Like, he ripped the offensive lineman's helmet off and swung it at his, hit him in the head?
Dude.
That was nuts.
Out of control, man. And that's a program that you know, you think would have a little bit tighter of a culture, right?
Yeah.
Have dudes throwing fisticuffs at fall camp. That wasn't even fisticuffs. That was like straight up assault, dude. Like
a lot of times stuff like that happens, like, oh, that happens in every football program in America. And like that is true for sure. But to rip a guy's helmet off like that and swing it on him, like, I don't think that happens.
I don't think that happens in every football program. Yeah. No.
Yeah, that was a battery.
There's some other frustrations that are happening there that are much deeper than just these two guys whenever something like that happens.
Probably so. Probably more than football too.
Definitely so.
Yeah, for sure. Last note for me on the defense, seems like Elijah Newell has been impressing people with his athleticism.
Yes.
That video that we mentioned earlier, they asked the guys, like, who would you put on your starting five for a basketball team for UTSA? Elijah Newell got a lot of shout outs. So that guy must be super athletic, right?
He is super athletic. To be a true freshman. The dude was a three-way sports star in high school, played both ways. Right, he was a running back as well as a defensive back, safety. Whenever he was in Arkansas at high school,
Ironman
played basketball, track and field. Yeah, I mean the dude is very, very athletic, natural athlete. What we call that man.
Yeah, I love those kind of athletes at safety as well.
Yeah, it's a perfect spot for a guy like that. Yeah, just a ball player and big shoes to fill with safety. And I think Elijah could be one of those guys come up and be really, really strong for UTSA for many years.
Yeah, for sure. He's got some good good seniors ahead of him to learn from. Ken Robinson and, Ellie Davison.
Yes.
Right? Two veterans that have played a ton of snaps. They play the game the right way. They know the defense and all that. So great for guys like Elijah Newell, Kenyon Kelly, to be under the tutelage of some real vets like that. Mm. Well, cool. Adrian, let's wrap things up with a little bit about talk about the offense, man. It sounds like McCown is doing well. Sounds like ELM is doing well. Coach did seem pretty authentic when he said, I feel very comfortable playing both of them, right? I could put both out there as a starter and feel great about it. I think by now, in his fifth year at UTSA, we kind of know when he's fibbing a little bit. Don't you think?
I think the very next sentence he said that Lyle Narcisse, JoJo Weeks, and Frank Harris were all starting quarterbacks as well.
Yeah,
like, he's just trying to keep the culture high.
I'll give you a little.
Yeah, I'll give you a little. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, for sure. Both guys mentioned that they're feeling, you know, a healthy amount of pressure to go out and execute. And I mean, that's what you want in a quarterback battle, even though I think both of us are in agreement it's not really that much of a battle. But you're still pushing both guys to be their best and, you know, to execute at a high level because it is it's the most pressure induced position in sports. Mm-hmm. Right. So
absolutely.
I think you had to be comfortable operating in that kind of environment, and you know, just like we've heard Owen say, you know, be able to flush, you know, the three interceptions in a row and just go out and be your best self and execute the offense. So good to hear. Sounds like both guys move the ball around. One thing that really caught my ear was when Owen, I think someone asked him, like, what are you developing on or whatever, and he said that he's really focused on learning the next step of the offense, and he particularly mentioned understanding all the different pass protections and then knowing all the hot routes, right? To me, that's what really makes the difference between the backup quarterback and the starter.
Talking like a starter, right?
You know that playbook in and out. You know where the ball's going before it's snapped. We saw that so much with Frank Harris. I mean, we'd be sitting next to each other in the stands, and I would tap you. I was like, oh, he's got the out route from the slot receiver wide open. He's going to throw it to him on the RPO. Boom, done. There you go. 8 yards, right? So when you can execute flawlessly like that and just anticipate how you're going to distribute the ball pre-snap and stuff like that, have that really nice flow of the offense like we've seen from Owen at times throughout his career at UTSA, the Tennessee game, namely, that was what was really exciting for me and shows like a real development as a game manager and as someone who's comfortable in the pocket. So that was great to hear. That was very encouraging for me.
Very, very encouraging, man. This is a guy, like you said, dude, he's got the fundamentals down pat, right? Now he's getting to the intricacies, getting to master those.
Yeah, exactly. And he didn't mention, you know, building chemistry with the receivers. That's always what the new quarterback says. You know, we're getting to know each other, learning the breaks, learning the tendencies. He didn't say that. He said, I'm in football level 300, right?
All
the deep stuff. So that was nice.
And to hear that 2 weeks, 3 weeks prior to game one, right? Yeah. The dude is cerebral, man. Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
Definitely. And, you know, Traylor did say, you know, the other quarterback's not there yet, right? So if there was anyone holding out hope for a Demetrius Davis surprise, doesn't sound like it's likely to happen.
Right.
But, yeah. You know, good to hear that, you know, Traylor did show a pretty big gap between the one and twos and the rest, right? Which I hope says more about the ones and the twos than it does the threes and the fours and the fives, but you never know.
Right. Yeah, man. Really, really good stuff, I think, from the offense. We saw some pretty good highlight plays.
Yeah.
From the guys in the clips.
Yeah,
right?
We saw a touchdown from Devin McEwen. I think that he scored over Zach Morris on that one.
Mm-hmm.
But of course, like, they had the video crop so much, you can't even really tell if it was the quarterback's fault or not, because, you know, they could have been in a cover two and the safety didn't pick up on the corner route and Morris was like chasing after him. You know, who knows? But still really nice to see Devin out
impressive.
There doing his thing, right?
Yeah. Yeah. You see his talent. His talent was on full display, no doubt.
Right. I noticed in those scrimmage highlights, they posted a lot of broken tackles from the running backs.
Yeah.
And it wasn't like a terrible attempt at a tackle, but just like good cuts, you know, stiff arms and stuff like that from running backs. You know, I'm going to give more credit to the running backs than criticize the defense on that.
Right. Right. Well, and we know we don't go, you know, full contact, full tackle in practice. Right. But like you said, the cuts, the stiff arms, the guys were making the right moves at the right moments in the right spots. Yes.
Right.
So, looking
electric while doing it.
Yeah. I think that deserves to be mentioned.
Yeah. And speaking of looking electric, man, Will Henderson, the true freshman from Gilmer.
Yes, sir.
They got to find a way to get him some touches, man.
Fast.
That dude skates on the field, man. It's like a hummingbird, man.
The first word in his bio is speedy. Speedy running back. Yes, yes. The dude is fast. He's quick. A lot of torque, a lot of acceleration. Yep. He's fast, man. Yeah. Yeah, that's exciting to see. Really exciting to see. Especially from a Gilmer boy.
He's going to be a very, very special player for UTSA this year. And I hope they can find that balance of, you know, getting him some run, giving him some touches, giving him some chances, while still keeping that red shirt. Because they don't need him this year.
No.
Something has to go terribly wrong for them to need him this year. So I really hope that he gets his three games, you know, has, you know, 300 rushing yards or whatever it might be. That would be a lot. Let's tune that down to 200. 150.
Yeah, 150. 150, yeah.
But, you know, it still gets to keep that year of eligibility.
It's I got to imagine Traylor's got to have some, you know, deep down emotion to get his Gilmer guy out there running down, you know, and I know he doesn't want to play any favorites, but come on, it's Gilmer, dude.
Yeah.
You got him.
Tennyson's not ready at quarterback, obviously. He still has a long way to go, but man, that running back room, it's easy to slot a freshman in at running back. We've seen the pros and cons of that throughout the year as a UTSA, so.
He sees it. He sees it, man, and he's like, let's go.
I wonder if, like, this time next year, we're going to get a quote from Traylor, like how we got for Patrick Overmeyer, where he was like, yep, I had a touchdown play for him, schemed up in the bowl game, but I didn't want to use it because I didn't want him in the portal.
Oh, my gosh. Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised. Yeah. I would not be surprised.
Well, it's exciting. I mean, I know every program in America is full of optimism right now. I mean, it's hard to lose fall camp, obviously. But I have a lot of you know, earnest optimism in this team. You know, expectations for me are really solid for sure. And it's just, you know, I've said this previously, but it just feels like a team that's very comfortable with themselves, very comfortable with who they are, with what they do, how they play, how they operate off the field, all that stuff. It's a program, right? It's not just a team. And that's always been the thing that we've said with Traylor, right? Like, has he had a generational quarterback or has he really built this thing? Right, we're gonna get that answer this. I think we started to get that answer last year, right?
Yeah.
Frank was not Frank last year; he was hurt a lot. But this is the year that's really gonna determine, right? Is this built to last or not. And
you're really,
so far, the old, early results are promising, but, you know, talk to us after week two, right?
You're really going to see a roster of Jeff Traylor's guys out on the field, guys that he brought to this campus, not just developed, that were already on campus when he got here.
Man, how many Wilson recruits are left on the roster? Like five or less, if I had to guess.
Has to be extremely small.
I'm not going to sit here and try to list many of them. But
how many are actually, you know, getting playing time?
Playing time, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's awesome, man. That's, you can see that athleticism is different. The length, the speed, the size.
It's coming, baby.
Yeah, it's coming.
It's coming, you know, and we're still 2 weeks out from our official season predictions, and I waver, Jared, but, you know, we have a football media day, and we get to see the highlights, and then I'm like, I get all super bullish and high again, and I'm like, am I being too confident right now? Right, yeah, I don't know. Right. We'll see, dude. We will see. Yep.
Absolutely. Well, I hope you guys enjoy this one. Longest episode we've done in a while. We had an hour, 7 minutes on my clock right now. Just strict talking football, man. Like no other sports, nothing. Just straight UTSA football. That's a really good feeling. If you want more, we'll be back with another Patreon episode. I guess we need to do some more position previews. Mm-hmm. Adrian, we got a request for the secondary on the Patreon chat. Yeah, should we commit to that one on the spot and say that one's not coming next?
I think we can. I think we can definitely do that. We'll follow up linebackers with the secondary, the defensive backs, the ones that
awesome.
Jeff Traylor says that cornerback room is going to be A-OK.
A-OK.
Talk about some of those guys. Yeah.
Awesome. Well, cool. If you made it this far in, thank you for listening. Or if you're on YouTube for watching, be sure to give a thumbs up, give a 5-star. We've got a perfect 5-star rating on Spotify. Which I found out recently. That's pretty cool.
Nice. So
thank you for everyone who went out of your way to do that without us asking. That's great. Appreciate you guys. And we'll see you guys back really soon on Patreon or back on the main feed.